Church council meeting this week?
If we hope, yes.
We hope. Yes.
Okay. We're off again, on again meeting, so we're on for Tuesday night at 7.
Tuesday night, 7 o'clock.
Yes, sir.
You can watch. Let's see. That choir is very good, aren't they? Yes. Give a round of applause for them. And Rosie's not too bad at Approach the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
A reading from Philippians, the first chapter. For me, living is Christ and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means spiritual reign over me. And I do not know which I prefer. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and to be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for me. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I may share abundantly in the boasting of Jesus Christ when I come to see you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. But then this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well. Since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. This is the word of the Lord.
Okay, I want to tell you a story. It's actually happened. saying it happened to me. The story goes like this. When I was a little boy, well, not so little, maybe about 10, 9 or 10, yeah, something like that. One morning at breakfast, my dad said, "Son, we just got a load of wood. It came on the dump truck yesterday afternoon, and they piled it and ran it right down in our driveway. We need to move that pile of wood and pile it up in the woodshed, so that we will have it all ready to go when winter comes, so that we can carry it in nice and put it in our stoves and keep the house nice and warm and make dinner and keep the water hot and everything else that we do." He said, "Can you help me out with it?" And I said, "Sure, yeah, you know, I was helping him." My dad especially wanted to pay. Okay, so we started working. Or did I tell you I had two brothers also? Not yet. Yes. Yes, I did. Okay. So anyway, we started working about, right after breakfast. And about noon, that's how we were getting, we were going to make it by the end of the day and get all that wood moved from that truck of wood into the woodshed. So we had lunch, and then he asked my next brother, who was a little younger than I, "Would you please come and help us pile the wood in the woodshed? Because we're not going to make it if we don't have a little help." And I'll tell you. And my little brother said, "Jeff, sure, we'll go out for the help. Why don't you care?" And then, oh golly, we were working all day long. It got to be about 3 o'clock or 3:30, and we got time for the afternoon snack. So my mom and my little brother, and they brought us and made some fresh cookies and I think maybe some nice cool Kool-Aid or lemonade or something, a nice drink. And so we did all of that, and we were having a good snack, and then said, "Time to go back to work." Then he asked our little brother, who was probably not much bigger than you, they said, "You better help us too, because we better make sure we get all this wood in, because it might rain tonight. That will be all wet and dry on everything." He said, "Can you help us?" "Yeah, we brought some gas." And that took all day. So, all my little brothers and me, we were working today and we were doing that with the woodshed. And you know what? We got it all with dinner. So, when Dad got all excited when we were all done, and he said, "Well, let's go have dinner." I said, "Your mom's got dinner ready." And my golly, he did. She did. So, we all had dinner. Dinner, and he said to us boys, "You guys worked really hard today, and I appreciate it very much. When we got the wood in the woodshed, it'll be nice and dry. I'm getting to that. I'm going to pay you now." So we started with my wee little brother, one about your size. And he gave a $5 bill. And then he gave my other brother, who started about noon, he gave him another $5 bill. And I was the last one to get paid. And I said, "Well, I've been here all day long and I sweat and I just worked hard. You know how much he gave me? $5 bill." Yeah. And guess who grumbled?
You.
Me? Yes, I did. I was grumbling. I worked all day long and everybody else got the same amount of money and didn't work as long as I did. So I told my dad, I said, "You know, what's it doing? You were out working all day long and I only get $5. And you, my little brother Flanagan, he just came out and kind of smiled and messed around and you paid him $5. Now, that's not fair." My dad said, "Well, didn't I ask you to work and then you're paid? Say, he said, "Whatever, you know, got paid the same amount of money. Some of us worked harder than the rest. What do you think the moral of that story would be? What is the reason I told you that story?
Preach the sermon in about 5 minutes, which takes me 15. Oh. What did you think about that gospel lesson for today? What was your reaction to it? Anybody got a feeling about it? Did it raise some kind of an emotion or whatever in your heart or in your head? Let me just get started. Because I think it's one of the more strange gospel lessons that we have, the strangest parable. Let me start out with an old family circus comic strip. In this comic strip, it shows two little boys, Billy and Jeffy, and they were squabbling with their mom about the size of the slices of pie that she was putting on the plate before them. And Jeffy pouts a little bit to his mom and said, "Mom, they aren't the same size." Well, Mom wants to be fair. She tries again. She evened up the slices, and still little Jeffy's upset. "They still aren't the same," he whines. This time Mom uses a ruler and absolutely proves that both slices of pie are exactly the same. "But Mom," Jeff complains, "I want mine to be just like Billy's, only bigger." That's like kind of us, isn't it? We all tend to think we deserve a bigger slice of the pie. From the time we are little kids, we are taught that doing more is worth more. You don't have to answer this, but I'm going to ask this question. Did you get an allowance as a kid? That was kind of like the weekly reward for doing the chores that you were your responsibility to do. If so, you probably had your allowance and the amount of work you did to earn that allowance as you go up, as your age go up, did your allowance go up? Say, for example, you're 5 years old and you get $1 for picking up their toys and your clothes. And maybe you grow up to be eight and you get given $5 for feeding the dog, emptying the garbage, and vacuuming the living room. Then you're 12. Then you should get considerably more, you think, for mowing the lawn and doing some laundry, watching your younger brothers and sisters, then cleaning the garage. Chores and allowances teach kids that in this world's economy, we have to work in order to receive our rewards. We want our kids to learn to live the adage, hard work pays off. I was taught that, and I think I probably taught it to my own children. I remember one of my first jobs for real money, I was peddling papers. I was probably about 10 years old. This was up in northern Michigan, up there in the UP. I peddled 100 newspapers every day, or not every day, Monday through Saturday. Rain or shine, nice summer weather, and freezing cold, snowy blizzard, wintry weather, up and down the side of the hill that went down to the canal that separated part of the peninsula. And I didn't mind it. I had to walk down almost to the canal to get the papers, and I had to walk back up the hill a little bit and then start my paper up. It took me almost 2 hours to do the run. But I worked hard, and I got paid. We just got more jobs like that. But, you know, we learned that. We were taught that. That is why this parable that I just read for you is kind of unsettling. It's easy to identify with the grumbling guys who work from sunup to sundown, right through the heat of the day, and then watched in amazement at some slackers who just showed up, worked for only a measly little hour, in the cool of the approaching evening, got paid a full day's wage. That just wasn't right. Of course, those that work the full day expect more. And of course, the full day worker, we think, should get more. It's only fair, right? True. More work should equal more wages. Hard work pays off. That's built into our DNA. That's how we do it. What I've just done, I think, what I'm trying to do is give you a sense of how real this problem really is and how destructive it can be to our human relationships. But what can we do so that we are not tempted to covet something that someone else has or is? How do we get around that? We don't want to covet things, do we? We don't want to be resentful of other people. We don't want to envy others because they got a little bit more than we did. I think the first step to recognize that envy and jealousy do exist, and that they can be destructive to our own well-being or even cause us harm in some way, the person that we envy. You got to recognize it. Aesop had a fable. It's kind of always an interesting read, okay? And the fable was about two eagles. One was envious of the other because the other could soar so very high and so elegant than this other one could. So the envious eagle would pluck the strongest feathers from his own body and shoot them as arrows, trying to wound or kill this other eagle who was flying so elegant. It was his own undoing, though. He could not hit this high-flying eagle, and he was eventually grounded by his own lack of feathers. Envy destroyed the eagle. It's kind of funny. But, you know, it could happen. It does happen. You know, for example, even in the church, in the choir, in the Sunday school class, in the church committee, even on the church council, anywhere. We need to understand, folks, that envy is a devious strategy that the devil uses to divide us up and to delay the coming of the kingdom of God. Envy or jealousy can show up anywhere,
Even
in church. Second thing I kind of want you to think about is, as we deal with envy, is to develop a strong attitude of gratitude. If I've said that once here in this pulpit, I've said it a billion times. We need to develop an attitude of gratitude for the things that we do have. The sparrow complained of Mother Nature one day. You gave beautiful colors to the peacock and the lovely song to the nightingale. But I am plain and unnoticed. Why was I made to suffer? You are not made to suffer, stated Mother Nature. You suffer because you make the same foolish mistake as human beings. You compare yourself with others. Be yourself, for that in that there is no comparison and no pain. Folks sometimes like just being fair. So we try to deal with the unfairness. Like the little truck driver, just the little guy who had parked the semi on Highway Cafe and had gone in for lunch. While he was sitting there perched on a stool, three big old motorcycle guys came in and began picking on him. They grabbed away his food and they laughed in his face. Well, the truck driver said nothing. He got up. He paid for his lunch and he walked out. Well, and one of the cyclists laughed to the waitress and said, "Boy, he sure wasn't much of a man, was he?" And the waitress replied back, "No, I guess not. Well, he's not much of a truck driver either," she said, pointing out the window. "He just ran over three motorcycles." You know, many of us are wonderfully blessed. And I don't think sometimes we think we are, but we are wonderfully blessed. If we daily counted our own many blessings, we would spend less time envying the blessings that our neighbor has. By the way, if you are a person who has been blessed more than the average person, you should guard against flooding those blessings. Tuck that in there for free. There's a story about a group of mountain climbers who set out to conquer a mountain. Among them was one with no experience at climbing a mountain at all. And for many hours they climbed. And once they got to the top of the mountain, the first timer stood straight up with his arms raised and yelled, "I did it!" As he celebrated his climbing accomplishments, a strong gust of wind almost blew him off the mountaintop. It was then that the more experienced climbers in the group explained to him that when you get to the top of the mountain, you never stand up straight, but rather you drop to your knees to avoid being blown off the mountaintop. Good advice, I think, for almost any situation. And the third thing I want to say as you deal with envy or covetousness or jealousy is to realize that some of the happiest people in the world have a servant attitude toward life. They actually take pride in seeing others succeed. In fact, they even work to help others succeed. Question number three. What do you do when someone comes along who shines more brightly than you do? You pray for them? You encourage them? Or do you envy and fear get in the way? Some of the happiest people in the world take pride in the success of other people. They are the encouragers. We have them right here in our church. People who serve Christ by putting themselves in second place, in order to ensure that there is harmony in the body of Christ. That's how you overcome envy, folks. At least the few ways that I thought of for this morning. Recognize that envy can be a problem in your life. Develop a strong attitude of gratitude for the things you have, and pray for those you're tempted to envy. You can do it. So my guess, my prayer is, please do it. Please do it. You'll never figure out how you got to be safe. Amen. remember the hymn of the day, but I know it was the truth.
Great is thy
faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Yeah, please stand. After you pass out your prayer request to the aisle so that the good doctor can pick them up. Great is thy faithfulness. Sing this one. It's a beautiful hymn.
Show us how best to care for the earth and its creatures. merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
God who is ready to relent from punishing, impart your compassionate wisdom to legislatures, judges, members of the military, and law enforcement. Give them courage to serve their community in times of uncertainty, stress, or exhaustion. Merciful God.
Receive our prayer.
God who saves, direct your people who are tempted by evil ways. Protect your children from calamity and disaster. Strengthen all who are incarcerated. Encourage all who are in despair or pain of any kind, especially Robin, Dolly, Werner, Juan Luis, Viviana and Heraldo, Calista, Don and Barbara, Earl, Yvonne, Emily, Margaret, Nicholas, Nina, Nora, Suraj, Alicia, Aileen, Garcia and family, Sharon, Timmy, Nestor, Eunice, Greg, Angeles, Diane, Natalie, Kimberly, and a special prayer for David Dickers, with thyroid cancer. This is Dottie's nephew. And Dr. Ruben Peñaranda, having surgery this morning. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God who is slow to anger, may we boast about the goodness of Jesus with the confidence of Paul in prison. Inspire us to find abundance in whatever vocation we are called to do in the world and in service to your congregation. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God who abounds in steadfast love, we give thanks for all saints called to the kingdom of heaven. United with them in spirit, hold us firm as we labor in this life and look to the life to come. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Remember us according to your steadfast love as we offer these and the prayers of our hearts. Trusting in your compassion, may through Jesus Christ. Amen.
I also would like you to remember in your prayers Andre Benner, his wife Susan. Susan's mother died yesterday. Folks, the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Share the peace. Your gifts and your offerings.
Let us pray. God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table, that they all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
At this point, I'm going to change this just a little bit. I'm going to ask you, if you can, to please rise at this time.
Is it indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sins, who in dying has destroyed death, rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
questions? Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray, blessed be your name, O God, for we have feasted on your word. Jesus Christ, the joy and delight of our hearts. Strengthened by his food, send us to gather world to your banquet, where none are left out and all are satisfied. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Folks, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father.